right, folks, it is freezing. It's like 10 o'clock at night, but we just had a late dinner here at Shogun Steak and Sushi. And I decided to come out here on the motorcycle, but it's very cold in California. So I'm going to tell you about my true ghost story. Absolutely true. It is getting in October, so we'll tell you about some true ghost story that happened to my family. I believe it was more of a demonic story, but call it what you will, something spiritual. This event that I'm about to talk to you about is one of the reasons of many of why I left atheism, and it caused me to believe at least in the spiritual realm. So before I tell you the ghost story, I promise you it will be interesting. We do this every year. So am I going straight here? I want to remind you that the Shock of God challenge will be updated once again in January of 2020. Okay, wants me to go left here. So as you know, every year we challenge atheists to answer the Shock of God challenge. That challenge is to give us some proof and evidence that would finally at last prove that atheism is accurate and correct. And we have had zero atheists that have been successful in answering that challenge. Oh, it's going to be so cold. Cold and dark and spooky going back northbound on California, in California. Wow, this is like the longest Green Arrow. It's awesome. Here's the freeway we're getting on. Hopefully you can hear me. We're going to be hitting some good speeds here. So we just have a few more months. By the way, getting on the freeway, I'm just going to keep going. It's yellow. Few more months till it's January 2020. And the atheist would have failed the challenge again. Before we get into the spooky ghost story, let's go through a list of atheists that you may know right here on YouTube that have tried to defeat the Shock of God challenge, but were unable to do so. Let's start off with the most famous YouTube atheist on YouTube, Richard Dawkins. We asked Richard Dawkins to provide proof and evidence that atheism is accurate and correct, and he said that he's not claiming God. Let me do it in my Richard Dawkins voice. We're not claiming God doesn't exist. We're saying we lack a belief in God. This is the limp-wristed, can you see my limp wrist here? Limp wrist imitation. I'm pretending I'm an atheist. Limp-wristed response that atheists have. They say, well, we're not claiming God doesn't exist. We are claiming, what the heck? It says hazard next 2 miles and there's a cloud with rain coming down. Oh, no. No, we don't. In 200 feet. There's nothing here. What is it? What are they talking about? So Richard Dawkins was unable to defeat the Shock of God challenge. Let's go pick this up here. The other atheist you may heard of, the amazing atheist. I call him the amazingly hellbound atheist because there's certainly nothing amazing about, oh, there's a motorcycle behind me. good. I was hoping it wasn't a cop. So there's certainly nothing amazing about choosing hell instead of heaven. So the amazingly hellbound atheist, the amazing atheist, failed to answer the Shock of God challenge. What he said was he's not claiming God doesn't exist. He's claiming that he lacks limp wrist again. Can't see it because it's dark out. He's claiming that he lacks belief in God. Other atheists that failed, have you heard a godless engineer? Have you heard, he failed. He too admitted that God can't exist. Admitting God can't exist does not help atheists. Thunderfoot failed. Aaron Raw failed. Lawrence Krauss failed. We have had zero atheists that have been able to defeat the Shock of God challenge. And now, ladies and gentlemen, let's get into my true ghost story. When I was a kid, we lived in a rural area of Southern California. And we lived on, some people said there were Indian, like cowboy and Indian, not Indian what type of curry do you want with your spicy chicken? I'm talking about Indian, redskin Indian. So we believe that it could have been something from that, but everything was peaceful in the house until, as a snot-nosed little kid, I did something very, very dangerous. I did something very, very stupid. What had happened is I got a Ouija board and my aunt and I, my sister, we started messing with the Ouija board. Now, for those of you that don't know what a Ouija board is, it's a board with a bunch of letters on it of the alphabet, and also it says yes and no, and there's numbers, different types of symbols. And the idea of the Ouija board is that you open up another realm, a spiritual realm. Doesn't it sound so stupid? But wait till I tell you what happened. But first, let's get in front of this car here for the speed up. So, if you look up in the dictionary, well, let me save that part for a surprise. So, what had happened? Everything was peaceful in the house. It was a old colonial style house. You know, the type that looks similar to the White House in Washington, D.C. with the pillars. Let's go over here. With the long pillars out front, you know, almost like a house that Thomas Jefferson or George Washington would live in. And, let's get back over here. So, we started messing around with this Ouija board. And another thing I forgot to tell you about the Ouija board, there's a plastic or wooden, depending on the quality of the Ouija board. Mine was a cheap little plastic. They have a name for it. I don't know what it's called. Because after I did the Ouija board once, and with this experience I had, I never did it again. But there's a little, you guys will know what it is. It's this little plastic thing with felt on the feet of it. There's like 3 feet to it. And there's a clear round circle in the middle, like a lens of the binoculars or a magnifying glass. And you look through this lens, this little plastic see-through lens, and it'll, you know, suspend itself, you know, over on these feet. It'll suspend itself over different letters and different numbers. Now, what you do is, imagine you're facing the motorcycle right now, like you're right in front of it. Just pretend we're stationary, and you're facing me. And that little disc, that little plastic device, is on the Ouija board in front of us. And your fingertips, let's see, I'll put my fingertips kind of right here by the phone. You can kind of see them here. Or actually, right here on the dashboard. Your fingertips lightly touch this plastic device with the little magnifying glass window over it. And my fingertips, I'm facing you, you're facing me, touch the other side of this device. And what you do, you just hold your fingers lightly on this device, and there's some physics involved, I'll grant you that. And it's a combination of you doing it, you kind of moving it side to side, and then some people say, and I believe this happened to me, that either something spiritual, demonic, whatever, it actually comes there, the presence of this spiritual being comes within the room, and all of a sudden, and you'll feel it, you'll feel this presence, at least I did, a very strong feeling that you've never felt before. So it's very, you can't explain it. It's sort of like, I can't explain it, but it's like you feel it. It's like, imagine you're in a room and someone else comes to the room and they have such a strong presence about them, yet you can't see them, but you feel the presence. Well, so my aunt and I were doing this Ouija board thing, and we're just stupid little kids, right? Snot-nosed little kids. And something happens. It starts moving very sporadically, and we're barely touching it. And all of a sudden, when it does that, my aunt and I were looking down at the board. We instinctively look up at each other like with a dun-dun-dun, surprised prairie dog. Look up surprised prairie dog on YouTube. You'll see what I mean. And as we look up, let's get around this thing. We both look up at the exact same time because we felt something like a presence. And also the little dial thingamajiggy on the board starts moving around. We're barely touching it, starts moving around very sporadically. And if you ever see people that are doing the Ouija board and they'll catch upon a spirit, a demon, they'll say, "Are you doing it?" And then the other person will say, "No, I'm not, no, you're doing it," you know. And you'll see them actually argue back and forth, accusing the other person that they're doing it. And it's funny until you start asking questions. So we started asking various questions, and one of the questions that dumb snot-nosed little kids ask are, you know, are you a boy or a girl? And I had a question, I wanted to ask it, but we asked, are you a boy or a girl? And then we asked, this is the question I asked, okay. Oh, and it slides to yes or no or B-O-Y for boy, you know, and it actually spells it out. You don't even have to look at the board. You could have a third party there taking notes, which is what we had. So when it is so cold, so bear with me. I'm trying to get the words out. It's freezing. Where's that global warming they were talking about that California was going to get? So, I ask it, do you know when the end of the world is going to come? What a cheesy, corny question. I'm not even a Christian yet. And if I was a Christian, I wouldn't be doing the Ouija board, but certainly we're going to have a new heaven and a new earth. You know, now I'm a Christian. So there's not going to be an end to the world. It's going to be a new world. It's not going to be like there's not going to be an earth. We're going to have a new earth, the new and improved earth. So the question I asked was actually stupid, but I asked it, and it said yes. Slid to Y, slid to E. Well, actually, I apologize. That Ouija board has like a yes and a no. So it just kind of slides to yes, you know, if you're asking yes or no question. But then I said, when? And it hesitated, and then it spelled out Anno Domini, which, you know, I've never heard of that word before. Even a lot of you that are adults have never heard of that word before, because it's not a word. I believe it's Latin. It's not a word that people use in any type of modern day speech, unless you're talking about a calendar or you're talking about an event. So when we looked up Anno Domini, because we didn't just sit there and look it up right then and there, but kind of freaked us out. And then I remembered what it said, and we had it written down. It actually spelled it out. And I'm like, I never heard of that word before, but it looks like a word. Like, it wasn't boobly blabbity blue. It was Anno Domini. I'll put the actual spelling of it right below in the video description here, so you can see what it spelled out, or what he spelled out, or whatever happened. So that night, I'm in bed, and you know, I didn't have a cell phone, and you know, I didn't have internet or anything like that. And I'm like, what if we got a dictionary around here? So I went and got a dictionary, and I'm turning the page, and I'm like, crap, and it's in the dictionary. So when I read it, it says, and I don't remember the actual definition to that dictionary, because, you know, some dictionaries will have five different definitions, but it basically, it's talking about the birth of the Christ child, the coming of the Christ child into the world. It's, I believe it's the abbreviation for AD, BC, or something like that. And so that obviously was pertaining to the question that we asked. So that freaked me out, but wait, it gets worse. At that time, I was an atheist. I was not a Christian, obviously, because Christians know better than to do something so stupid as to mess with the Ouija board. But anyways, I started to believe there's something to the spiritual realm. I didn't fall on my knees and say, I'm a sinner, you know, when I confess Jesus Christ as Lord. I didn't do that right then. But this was getting to be peculiar to me. It was some type of proof and evidence that something obviously happened. But then this was confirmed when one night, very late at night. So right now I'm doing this at like 10:35, but it was probably like 12-ish midnight, a little after 12. And one of the problems of being on a motorcycle, people in front of you think you're a cop sometimes, so they go real slow. Or get out of your way. That's good too. Thank you, sir. So one night we're sleeping, and we had this big room. My sister and I were little kids. We slept in this big room. We had two different beds and two little nightstands and stuff, and our light started going on and off. You know, that could happen, but it was just our lights. And that's not really enough to freak us out, but then we heard something. We started hearing heavy footsteps coming up the steps. Now, we had a spiral staircase. It was a nice house. But the spiral staircase had, like, carpet in the middle and then, like, wood on the side. You know how the middle of the steps, it's, you know, this was a long time ago, so the houses were, like, carpeted in the middle of the steps, but the side had, like, wood. So it's the wood steps, but with carpet, and you could hear someone coming up the steps. So my sister and I jump out of bed, and we're looking out the doorway, and as I look down the doorway, my mom and dad's bedroom was out to the left. So imagine this. If you look out to the left, that's where the steps end up at the top of the stairway by my mom and dad's bedroom. And then there's another hallway going in front of my sister and my room. So I look, and there's my dad in his Fruit of the Loom underwear and a t-shirt, because, you know, we're all sleeping, with a double barrel shotgun pointed in that direction as he's waving us to, like, go back in the room. Nothing was there visibly. Okay. Well, this happened again and again around that same time, and, like, nothing, like, was there. It would, you'd hear it come to the top of the steps, and then I don't know where it would go. It was just, like, silent. Almost like a recording stuck in time of some sort. But wait, ladies and gentlemen, there's more. Everything I'm telling you is not embellished. It's not exaggerated. You can trust me. This is truth. So then, you know, we're little kids. I'm sitting there watching cartoons or whatever, Tom and Jerry. And my dad's mother, she would come by sometimes and babysit us. And, you know, my grandmother on my dad's side, she comes in and she's freaking out, like looking at us like she saw something or whatever. And then she didn't say anything and she went back in. And she started saying, "This house is haunted," but she wouldn't tell us what she was seeing. And then her husband, my grandfather, he was a painter, an excellent painter, like a house painter. And, you know, like a handyman sort of guy and a house painter and stuff. And he was retired, but he would paint houses. So my dad said, "Hey, come on over and paint the house." And demons, spirits, you'll hear, they don't like when you change things on the house. So he's painting out back of the house, and we're on a lot of acreage. There's nobody around. And there's these little gravels, those little decorative gravels, like little rocks. And as he's painting, these rocks, he says, I didn't witness it, start hitting the side of the house like someone's picking them up, throwing them at him. And he looks and he doesn't see where it came from. And he comes on in and he's asking if we're throwing rocks, but he could see that we're inside the house. I don't know how, you know, he's right there by the sliding glass door. There's no way that we were doing it, nor would we do that. We love Grandpa. He has since passed away. But, so that happened. And then, one night, my sister, my aunt, everyone was over, you know, the house, and my grandparents and stuff. My sister and my aunt, the same two that did the Ouija board with me, they heard something in the kitchen, like a groaning noise, like someone in pain. And they freaked out, and we're all in the living room, and they come running out of the kitchen yelling. And they're saying, it's him, it's him. And because people were starting to say the house was haunted, they'd get weird vibes, they'd hear things, see things out of their corner of their eye. But wait, it gets worse. Now, this all came to a climactic event when my dad was in the den, like his office, and then there's another room, and then there's a kitchen, like a family room and then a kitchen. And he's in there making his schedule out and stuff, and as he's making out his schedule, he hears, again with the kitchen, something with the kitchen, he hears like glasses breaking in the kitchen. So he thinks it's my mom, my mother. But my mother's upstairs already, like, sleeping. Like 10 o'clock at night. So my dad comes out, and he sees it. And he looks, and to hear him tell the story, first, I know you want to know what it looks like, so let me tell that first. He said it looked like the head and shoulders of a man, but with no legs. He even drew it, and it looked kind of like a bell. You know, if you draw a bell, you know how it looks like the head and then kind of the shoulder part, but chopped off, no legs at all. So, let's get around this dude here. I better speed up. Car's coming up behind me quick. So he yells for my mom, and we're all, you know, sleeping. He yells for my mom like he's being murdered. And what happened, I forgot to tell you the most part. When he sees it, in the twinkling of an eye, rushes across the room right in his face, and it feels very cold to him. I'm getting chills just telling you the story. But of course, I'm freezing right now, so that just adds to it. And we go downstairs, and my dad's, you know, tan-skinned, you know, like, he's not white, he's more tan-skinned, you know, being out in the sun and stuff. And he looked like he was almost an albino, like someone that was dead. Like he's seen a ghost. Hold on, I got a downshift here. Fifth gear. We'll keep it fifth. So we come down there and he's freaking out. He's shaking like a leaf. He's, oh, go back to bed, you guys. Go back. You know, because he's a good dad. He doesn't want us to be scared. But really, Dad, go back to bed? I don't think so. What the hell just happened? So we were like freaking out. Now, we totally believe in the spiritual realm. This was not materialism. This was nothing that has to do with a natural cause. Oh, and my dad said it's like a dark cloud, like you're looking at the dark cloud, but you can see through it. Just like a cloud. You know how you see a dark cloud in the sky and it's dark, but if there were like a something behind it kind of close, like an airplane or birds, you could see through it. And then my mom was in the kitchen, again with the kitchen. I didn't really realize the kitchen was such a hotbed of spiritual activity till I started telling the story, and I noticed, oh yeah, everything seems to be like right there by the kitchen. Same thing where my dad got attacked. My mom was sitting in the kitchen and she got slapped. Hold on. Man, these bumps. On the shoulder. Hard. And we're sitting there in the living room, you know, watching TV again. And my mom comes out. She says, did you just come in and hit me? And it was then that I knew the jig was up. We had a haunted house. My sister and my aunt had heard it, and everyone was having these episodes, and I'm going to be honest with you, I was not interested in seeing it. I was terrified. And everyone, my mom was having issues with it. My dad was, and I was like, I'm not a Christian, but I'm like, God, please, please, you know, you've got to go ahead and protect me if you're really there. I'm just a little dumb atheist kid, and, you know, now when I need help, immediately I'm, you know, shouting out to a God that I've always claimed, you know, doesn't really exist, and it was stupid. But when you need God, that's when you are willing to beg for help. So that's my story. Demons are real. I know people that actually have seen demonic entities within their house. So God bless you guys. I love you. This is Shock. A few more months and the atheists will be failing the Shock of God challenge once again. Have a great week. And again, may God richly bless you and watch over you.